pray. Father, we thank you for your blessing. And Lord, we just ask you, Holy Spirit, just to open our hearts and minds, we pray, to what you want to do in this house. Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, the title of my sermon today is Don't Take Your Baggage to the Battle. You know, as we go through life, we pick up things that aren't good. We pick up offenses. Things happen. And they get in our heart and we don't even realize. Let me tell you something. When I was preparing this message, I thought I was scot-free. But God began to show me some things in my heart. See, human emotions are very complex. And you can be holding something in and not even know it. So I really want you to check your heart. And just see if there's anything that you picked up along the way that you may not even realize. Because it can crop up on you before you even know it. I want you to turn to Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 17. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9. This is God speaking. As the heart is more deceitful than all else and is desperately sick, who can understand it? God's the one that searches the minds and hearts. Let him search yours and see if there's some things in your heart. Turn to Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 17. You know the story of David and Goliath. His father told him, go bring these things to your brothers. So David arose early in the morning and left the flock with the keeper and took the supplies and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the circle of the camp while the army was going out in battle array, shouting the war cry. Israel and the Philistines drew up in battle array, army against army. Then David left his baggage in the care of the baggage keeper and ran to the battle line and entered in order to greet his brothers. He left anything that would hold him back, left it to the baggage keeper. You can say, Jesus is the baggage keeper. What did he say? Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He left it behind. Here is the reality that we are facing right now. Turn to 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12. Says, fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. We are in a fight. We're in a battle. The devil doesn't want God's will to be done, and so he's trying to do anything he can. And I will say that if you are going to get offended, you're going to get offended in the church. Sometimes we offend people. I'm sure I've offended people. Said things. Things came out the wrong way. Said things I shouldn't have said. You've done the same thing. Psalm 55 verse 12 says, for it is not an enemy who reproaches me, then I could bear it. Nor is it one who hates me, who has exalted himself against me, then I could hide myself from him. But it is you, a man, my equal, my companion and my familiar friend. We had sweet fellowship together, walked in the house of God in the throng. Things happen. The devil gets in. He puts thoughts in your head and makes you think things, and they get in your heart. The oldest strategy is what? Divide and conquer. We see that in our nation. We're so divided. This group and that group. This color and that color. This nationality, you know. I mean, it used to be we're all Americans. I mean, folks, we live in the greatest nation on the face of the earth, all right? Everybody's trying to get in here. Why are they trying to get in here? Because it's a great place to live. People can say it's a horrible nation all they want to, but nobody's trying to get in communist China. Nobody's trying to get in North Korea, are they? Or virtually any other nation. No, everybody wants to come here. Why? Because it is the best place to live on this planet because God has chosen to bless this nation. And because of the church. So I want you to just think about it. No, you don't have to go confess everything to everybody. This is something between you and God. Because you don't hurt the person that you're holding unforgiveness against. They don't even know. You're hurting yourself. You're holding yourself back. And so I think it's good to check our hearts. Okay, God. What's going on? I want to make sure that I'm right with you and that I'm right with my fellow brothers and sisters. The two greatest commandments, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So this is the foundation of every word that God has put into place. Love. Love is the foundation, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. See, what separates Christianity from all the other belief systems? It's that love. Jesus said, pray for those who persecute you. Pray for your enemies. It's a foundation of love. So let's understand that we are in a fight. But it's a fight. It's a good fight. Amen. It's a good fight. Romans 8, verse 37 says this, but in all these things, we overwhelmingly, wow, overwhelmingly, that sounds like over and above. We overwhelmingly conquer through him who what? Who loved us. We conquer through his love. We don't conquer the world's way by fighting back against people. No, we conquer through love. So let's take one thing that I think we need to watch out. Turn to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. Pursue peace with all men and the sanctification without which no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one comes short of the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springing up causes trouble, and by it many may be defiled. Turn to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. It says, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. How do we grieve God? By fighting with our brothers and sisters. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Now let's look at this word bitterness. The Greek word for bitterness is picra, which gives us our English term pyrrhic acid. This acid is one of the most acidic chemicals. Picric acid is, it's explosive. It's explosive. People who are bitter, they're explosive. They have uncontrollable anger. One minute, everything's fine, and then something sets off, and they just explode. If you have that explosive anger, you may need to check your heart. I mean, I've gotten upset and started yelling at the kids. And Katie's like, why are you yelling at the kids? I'm gonna mad. Well, guess what? That's bitterness. Let all explosive anger be put away from you. Nothing worse than somebody who just goes off and just, it's like it just makes the whole atmosphere just, ugh. Why? Because that's that acid, that's that bitterness that is defiling many. We don't want to be that person. That brings no glory to God whatsoever. So we've got to check our hearts. We don't want to be explosive. The word wrath comes from a Greek word meaning to move impetuously in a violent motion or passion of the mind. Another explosive, just out of control emotion. Slander is verbal abuse against someone with the desire to harm that person. Meaning, you want to slander that person because you want to ruin that person. We don't need to do that. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. James chapter 3, verse 14, again it said over and over again in the New Testament. James chapter 3, verse 14, but if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your heart, do not be arrogant and so lie against the truth. This wisdom is not that which comes down from above, but is earthly, natural, and demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there is disorder in every evil thing. Where you have bitterness, people that are bitter, there's chaos. See, that's what the devil likes to do. Stir up chaos. We see it in the nation. Embitter people for whatever reason, stirring up chaos, causing damage. That's the enemy. He's not a God of chaos. He's the Prince of Peace. So where the Spirit of God is in operation, and as we allow the Spirit of God to operate in our lives, then we bring peace to situations. We don't bring disorder and chaos. I mean, that's straight out of the communist playbook, right? Bring disorder and chaos in a society. I'm telling you, that's what's happening in our nation. We have people that are the communist mindset. They want to just disrupt society completely and establish it with a whole new form of government. I'm telling you, that's what's happening. But God. But the church. It's up to the church to lead the way in forgiveness. Because guess what? We couldn't have come to Christ if we had not been forgiven. How many sins have you committed? How many things have you done against people to hurt people? To do things in the past. Remember when I was growing up, I was not a violent person by any means, but for some reason, there was this one kid that got on my nerves, and I never was the kind to hit anybody, but I'll never forget it. I hit this guy in the stomach. I don't even know why I did it. And after I did it, I felt horrible because I saw the pain that I had inflicted on on that person. And that always comes to mind, you know what? I don't want to hurt anybody physically, but I don't want to hurt anybody emotionally either. Because I don't like people in pain. I don't like to be in pain, and I don't like to see other people in pain. Why? Because we have been forgiven by Christ. Now, it's a battle. The flesh wars against the spirit, and the spirit wars against the flesh. But it's a war that we can win because we overwhelmingly conquer through Jesus Christ and because of his love. See, David left his baggage. And what happened with him? He beat the giant. Maybe if there's an area in our lives that we just can't seem to conquer, maybe there's some things in our heart that we need to let go of. Here's how you can tell. If a person hurts you, if every time you think about that person or you see that person, it really bothers you, then you have to let it go. You still have something hanging on in your heart. But what did Jesus say? Matthew chapter 18, verse 22, when Peter was saying, well, how many times do I have to forgive my brother? Jesus said, 70 times 70 per day. Now, that's a lot. Nobody's going to do that much in you in a day. But basically, what Jesus was saying was, when it comes to forgiveness, we don't keep score. We lose count. See, we have a tendency, well, okay, that person did that to me, but I forgave him, so boy, I'm so righteous, I'm so great. No, you're not keeping score. You're losing count. You throw it over. It doesn't matter. Why? Because Christ forgave you. What about the parable? Matthew 18, verse 22 or 23. I'm not going to read the whole thing. But it says, for this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he had begun to settle them, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought up to them. That was a huge amount, okay? That was a huge amount. Thousands and thousands of dollars. But since he did not have the means to repay, his Lord commanded him to be sold along with his wife and children and all that he had in repayment to be made. So the slave fell to the ground and prostrated himself before him, saying, have patience with me and I will repay you everything. And the Lord of that slave felt compassion and released him and forgave him of his debt. Wow, what a wonderful thing. And then the story goes on. That same servant that was forgiven went to somebody who owed him far less and demanded his money. And the master said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have mercy on your fellow slave in the same way that I had mercy on you? That's what it's like when we don't forgive. Jesus has forgiven us of so much. And when we don't forgive somebody else, we're like that wicked slave. I mean, God has forgiven us of all sorts of terrible things that we've done and thoughts and motives and things. And yet somebody sins against us, does something one time, nothing compared to how we've sinned against God. And we're like, that person's going to pay. This is what Jesus was saying. Verse 34, and his Lord, moved with anger, handed him over to the torturers until he should repay all that was owed him. Wow. And then Jesus said this is a powerful statement. My heavenly Father will also do the same to you if each of you does not forgive his brother from your heart. Not just a verbal, I forgive you. No, you got to forgive him. You got to really forgive him from your heart. That's pretty strong words. But what does the Lord's Prayer say? We forgive others as you have forgiven us. Forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. See, that's what unforgiveness is. You're holding somebody to something. Well, you owe me. You owe me. You did this. You owe me. You owe me. You owe me. Let me tell you something. Nobody owes you anything. Nobody owes you anything. You've got to let it go. You've got to forgive. Paul said in the book of Galatians, through love, serve one another. In a marriage, that's what you do. You serve your spouse, and your spouse serves you. Husbands, you serve your spouse, whether your spouse serves you or not. Because the Bible says that husbands should love their wives like Christ loved the church. So husbands, it's on you to do the right thing no matter what your wife does. Now, I'm sure your wife always does the right thing. But it's not a marriage. It's not, okay, you do for me and I'll do for you. No, that's not what it is. It's a covenant. It's an agreement made before God that you are going to be faithful and you're going to honor your commitment and you're going to honor the word of God. It's the same thing with forgiveness. We've got to honor the word of God. Is it easy? No, it's not easy. Can it be a battle sometimes? Sometimes it's a daily thing. Paul said this. He said, I die daily. It's a daily commitment. It's a daily decision. Just like love is a daily decision, it's a decision every day that I'm going to walk in forgiveness and I'm going to honor God's word. It's not easy. Turn to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. So as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion. It's a decision that you make that you've got to put on. Put on a heart of compassion. Why? Why is a heart so important? Because your heart is the center of your belief system. It's the center of your faith. So when you're holding unforgiveness and bitterness, you're robbing yourself of faith that you need to press forward into God and receive what God has. Romans 10 says, for with the heart, a person believes. That's why the devil wants to get in your heart, clog it up, have you have all types of feelings and emotions about things so that you're not focusing on God and you're not believing God. Why? Because it's with the heart one believes. That's why it's so important that we daily watch and check, okay, God, is there anything in my heart that's holding me back from believing in what you want? And what you have for me. Is there anything holding me back from walking in faith? See, the Amplified Version in Hebrews chapter 11 says that faith is the title deed. A few weeks ago, I paid Katie's car off, and the other day, I got the title in the mail. What a great feeling. Yes. Well, guess what? Faith says you've already got the title. It works in opposite. You've got the title. Now you're waiting for the outward manifestation of what you're believing for. But you already own it. So if the devil can come in and clog your heart up to where your faith is stopped, then he can stop you from receiving everything God has for your life. That's why it's important. So important. So the best way that we can learn how to walk in forgiveness, turn to Luke chapter 7 as we close. I mean, we're not closing right this second, so don't get excited. Well, I hope you're not excited. Luke chapter 7, verse 36. Now, one of the Pharisees was requesting him to dine with him, and he entered the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. And there was a woman in the city who was a sinner. And when she learned that he was reclining at the table in the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster vial of perfume. All right, already people were judging this woman. Well, she's a sinner. Well, that meant she may have been a lady of the night. She may have had questionable morals. She was already being judged by men. And standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears and kept wiping them with the hair of her head and kissing his feet and anointing them with the perfume. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, well, if this man were a prophet, he would know who and what sort of person this woman is who is touching him, that she is a sinner. Now, Jesus knew his thoughts. See, God knows your thoughts. The devil doesn't know your thoughts. The devil cannot read your mind. So watch what you say. But God knows your thoughts. And then Jesus said, Simon, I have something to say to you. And he replied, say it, teacher. A moneylender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they were unable to repay, he graciously forgave them both. So which of them will love him more? And Simon answered and said, I suppose the one whom he forgave more. And he said to him, you have judged correctly. Turning to the woman, he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but she, since the time I came in, has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she anointed my feet with her perfume. For this reason, I say to you, her sins, which are many, have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves little. Then he said to her, your sins have been forgiven. And of course, again, the criticizers, there are always going to be those people that are, they're going to be critical. Those who are reclining at the table with him began to say to themselves, who is this man who even forgives sins? And he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. When we walk with a heart of gratitude for what God has done for us and how much God has forgiven us, man, we are wide open to receive what God has because faith, we have faith. He saw her faith because she understood that she was a sinner, yet Jesus was having mercy on her and forgiving her, and faith began to rise up within her. That's why we've got to let things go. We've got to put on a heart of compassion because I don't know about you, but I want faith to rise up into my heart. Put aside jealousy. You find yourself becoming jealous of other people. Guess what? You've got some offenses in your heart. That's a faith killer. Well, look at that person. I tell you what, I can't believe that. We've all thought it. Well, get that out of your head. Because guess what? God's got something for you. God's got blessings for you, but you can't receive it if we're looking at everybody else becoming jealous and envious. See, that's what the whole, I'm telling you, I'll go back to the communism thing. Communists, I mean, it's all built on jealousy and envy. Let's tear down the rich. Let's take over this society. And then what happens is nobody has anything except the government and the government officials. But people gave it up because of jealousy and envy. Don't give up your blessing over jealousy and envy over somebody else. Let me tell you something. God's got a life for you that is custom made, tailored fit for you. You let faith arise in your soul. You let all those things go. You believe in your heart with faith, and you're going to see God do great things. Don't fall prey to the devil's schemes. He's no respecter of persons. What he does for one, he'll do for another. So we have to let things go, and we have to focus on God and let faith arise in our heart and believe in the goodness of God. When you're full of jealousy and envy and bitterness, you can't believe in the goodness of God because you're so mad at everybody and everything else that you can't believe for yourself. There's nothing about being in a bad mood that stirs any faith within my heart. And I got frustrated about something last night and started yelling at the kids. Kids like, why are you yelling? I'm just angry. So remember how much Christ loved us. And also remember, Jesus said this, well, Paul said this, but it's Jesus' words anyway, Romans 12, verse 18. Go ahead and turn to this in Romans 12, verse 18. If possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. So pursue peace whenever possible. It's not always possible. I understand that. Some people just aren't going to, they're just not. But as much as it depends on you, never take your own revenge, beloved. He's speaking as a father. Never take your own revenge, beloved. But leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I'll repay, says the Lord. You let God even the score. Verse 21 says, do not be overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. So what do? We keep showing love. We keep forgiving. We understand that we have sinned much, but God has forgiven much. God doesn't hold it against us. So let's not hold it against other people. And as far as even in the score, just let God do it. And we don't wish bad on anybody. That's a sin too. We just say, God, I'm going to just trust you that you're going to do in my life what you said you were going to do. Remember, God will work everything to your good. Even a time when somebody hurts you, even an injustice that is done to you, God will work it to your good. He will work it to your good. What did he do for Joseph? Joseph sold into slavery by his brothers. They didn't even know where he was. And they just buried him in their minds, just forgot about him. He had the situation with Potiphar's wife. He was judged wrongly. He was sent to prison. But he prospered even in prison. And then he interpreted the dream, but he was sent back to prison. But in due time, God exalted him. And what did Joseph say? When he revealed himself, in Genesis 45, verse 4, then Joseph said to his brothers, please come closer to me. And they came close. And he said, I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. Now do not be grieved or angry with yourselves. Wow. Basically, he was telling his brothers, forgive yourself. You got to forgive yourself, too. Sometimes we're our worst critics. Do not be grieved or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. And again, he said it again, verse 7. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on the earth. And then verse 8, he said it again. Now, therefore, it was not you who sent me, but it was God. He was acknowledging, God, you're Lord over every situation in my life. You rule and reign, so I'm going to acknowledge your sovereignty, that you're going to make good on this, that nothing escapes you, that you are still Lord. See, if you confess him as Lord, okay, Jesus, you're Lord in this situation. I don't understand it. I don't understand what's going on, but I'm going to confess that you are Lord, and you know what you're doing, so I trust in you. So how do we walk in forgiveness? Number one, we realize how much God has forgiven us. Number two, we don't take vengeance. We leave it up to God. And number three, we acknowledge that Jesus is Lord over every situation in our lives, over every event, everything that happens. We say, you know what? You're Lord of all. I don't understand this, but Jesus, you're Lord, and I'm going to worship you. I'm going to praise you. How do you avoid getting offended with God? Let me tell you how you avoid getting offended with God. You give the same confession that Daniel did when he was getting ready to go in the fiery furnace. He said, I know my God can save me, but if he doesn't save me, it doesn't matter. He's still God. You won't get offended with God with that answer. Okay, God, I'm trusting you, but guess what? You're God no matter what, even when I don't understand it. You're Lord, you rule and reign, and your hand is on my life. And my confession is, no matter what I see, Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to give you a future and a hope, and your hope will not be cut off. You keep that as your confession, and faith is going to rise in your heart, and you're going to see God do awesome things in your life.
Amen.
Amen. And the devil's not going to be able to stop you. Trust me, God knows what he's doing. Even when you don't, when it makes no sense to you, he is Lord. Let me tell you, he is Lord over Canton Christian Center. He is Lord over every situation in your life. He is ruling and he is reigning.
Amen.
You keep that as your confession, and you're going to rise to the top every time. Every time. So make it a daily thing to check your heart. Okay, God, I don't want to have anything in my heart that can stop the faith that you put within me. See, unto each man is given the measure of faith. The faith is in there. And what the devil wants to do, what did Jesus say to Peter? I pray that your faith will not fail you. Because if he knows that if your faith doesn't fail, nothing's going to be impossible. You're going to be able to speak to the mountains if your faith doesn't fail. So the devil comes in and wants to bind you up with offenses and all and bitterness, explosiveness, so he can rob you of what? Of your faith. So let's just pray. Father, we thank you. Father, we just release our hearts to you, Lord. And Lord, we say that you are Lord over all. So Lord, we just pray that if anything is in our hearts that shouldn't be, Lord, right now we just release it to you. Lord, we let those things go. Lord, we let those people go, Lord. We just let it go. And we acknowledge that you are Lord over our lives. And so we give you praise. Just raise your hands for the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. So they shall invoke my name on the sons of Israel, and I then will bless them. Father, I thank you, Father, for your expectancy to be put within our hearts, Lord. Lord, that you've got good plans, Lord. You've got good things for us. Lord, I just ask you, Holy Spirit, that you'll touch us and move upon our hearts, I pray, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. And everybody said, amen, amen. Amen.